healing through the power of the Word of God. And this is going to be a very important key to receiving your healing. A lot of people seem to have this notion that healing is just up in the sky, some kind of magic, some kind of mumbo jumbo. And if some individual, some anointed individual, would lay his hands over you in particular, wave his hands and say, abracadabra, kaboom, all the sickness will be gone. We wish that was true, but unfortunately that is not true. Healing happens through the power of the Word of God and only through the Word of God. Say amen. And so if a Catholic doesn't know the Word of God, then it's not possible for you to experience the power of healing in your life, because it's not magic. Say it out loud. Healing is not magic. Tell the person sitting next to you, healing is not magic. Amen? So where is healing? Where is healing? The book of Wisdom, chapter 16, verse 12. The book of Wisdom, chapter 16, verse 12 says, neither herb nor application cured them, but your all-healing word, O Lord. It's not the herbs or not the application that cured them, but it is the healing word of God. So when you receive the healing word of God, or when the healing word of God is spoken over your life, then you and I experience the power of that healing in our lives. Say amen. Amen. Unfortunately, many Catholics do not know the word. And because they do not know the word, they are not able to tap into that healing. So they are waiting for somebody to come and lay hands over them so that they can receive the healing. The purpose of this talk is to encourage you to deepen your love for the Word of God, but not only your love for the Word, but allow the Word to transform you. Say amen. Amen. When the Word begins to transform your mind, when the Word of God begins to transform your mind, then your thought pattern starts to change. Romans chapter 12 verse 2. The Bible says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Repeat after me. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So how are you and I transformed? By the renewing of our mind. Say that. So if your mind is not renewed, friends, you can come for 250 healing sessions and nothing is going to change. Say amen. Amen. Tell the person sitting next to you, listen carefully, he's talking about you. Amen. Ouch. It's true. Why? Because all my life I've seen people run after some kind of miracle worker and not after Jesus. Jesus is the all-living Word of God. Say amen. Amen. And when the Word of God is alive and active in your life, then the healing begins to work in your life. Amen? Amen. So therefore, friends, you and I need to be transformed in our mind. When our minds are transformed, then faith begins to rise. Faith begins to rise. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God. How does faith come? By hearing the Word of God. How does faith come? Romans chapter 10 verse 17. So you and I need to hear the Word of God so that the Word of God will transform our way of thinking and we can receive that healing. A classic example of this is the story of Paul in Malta. Paul in Malta, there is two words that is used to describe healing. In Acts chapter 28, it says that Paul was in Malta and he was received by a leading man of the island by the name of Publius. Publius entertained Paul for 3 days. And when Paul was there, it so happened that Publius' father lay sick in bed with fever. Paul visited him and cured him by putting his hands on him. That was verse 8. Paul visited Publius' father and cured him by putting his hands on him. In verse 9, after this happened, The rest of the people in the island who had diseases heard about the cure of Publius' father. They also came. The sick also came and were cured. Say amen. Why? How? Now we go to the key of how does Paul activate this healing? How does Paul activate the healing in his life? What does Paul do? What is the key to Paul ministering healing in all of Malta? That so many people were healed. We find the key in the story of when Paul ministered in Lystra. Acts chapter 14. In Acts chapter 14 verse 8. It says, in Lystra there was a man who could not use his feet and had never walked. He had never walked, for he had been crippled from birth. When was he crippled? From birth. This is key, yeah? The man never ever walked. He was crippled from? This is very important. The man never ever walked. He was crippled from birth. This was in the city of Lystra. Paul was preaching. Paul was preaching the word of God. And the Bible says in verse 9, Acts 14 verse 9, he listened to Paul as he was speaking. This is a very important key. This man was crippled from? What was he doing? Listening to Paul as Paul was speaking. What was Paul speaking? The word of God. Paul was speaking the word of God. And what was the man doing? Once again, what was Paul doing? Speaking the word of God. What was the man doing? Listening to the word of God. When Paul, looking at him intently and seeing that he had faith to be healed, this is very important. Repeat this line after me. Seeing that he had faith to be healed. This is very important, huh? Why is this important? Because your faith can be seen. Or the lack of faith can also be seen. If you have faith, your faith can be seen. Or your lack of faith can also be seen. So Paul, imagine this, huh? Paul is standing in Lystra and he's speaking. There are many people, and amongst these people, there's a man who's been crippled from. He's sitting and listening intently to Paul as Paul is preaching. Paul can see everybody, but notices particularly this man. And as he notices the man, he notices the man had faith to be healed. Say amen. Amen. How did faith come? By hearing the word of God. Romans 10, 17. So as the man was listening to the word of God intently, his faith was rising. The man's faith was rising. And as the man's faith was rising, it was evident when Paul saw him, he could see the faith. Even Jesus, remember the story of the four men who brought the cripple down through the roof? The Bible says, Jesus, seeing their faith, healed the man. Faith can be seen. Paul, seeing his faith, said in a loud voice. Paul issued a command. Paul said, stand upright on your feet. He pointed to the guy and said, stand upright on your feet. Repeat. What is that? It's a command. Say, what is it? It's a command. It's not a prayer. It's not a request. It's a command. What is the command? Once again. Stand upright on your feet. Either Paul must be really, really dumb, or he really had a lot of faith. Because this man couldn't walk from. And yet, Paul issued a command. Stand upright on your feet. And the Bible says, the man complained. Correct? No. Look at the word. Don't nod your head. Look at the word. What did the Bible say? The man sprang up and began to walk. The man didn't say, excuse me, sir. Are you talking to me? Yes, Paul says. Yes, yes, I'm talking to you. Stand upright. Stand upright on your feet. I'm sorry, maybe you don't understand. I have been crippled from birth. I cannot walk. Sorry, sir. I cannot walk. I am crippled from birth. Did the man say that?
No.
No. What did the man do? Sprang up and began to walk. Did it write that the man complained? No. Tell each other, don't complain. Amen. Out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth will speak. Amen. So if there is faith, it will come out through your mouth. If there is lack of faith, it will also come out through your mouth. Amen. The man never complained. He activated his faith. Why? Because he believed the word of Paul. Amen. He believed the word of God. That's the key, friends. That's the key. If you catch this key, then you and I can tap into healing 24/7. 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year, all year round. Amen. Because the key is in the word. The key is in the word. Listen, the Bible doesn't say Paul came, laid hands over him, and prayed over him. Nothing. Paul never laid hands over him and prayed over him. What did Paul do? Preach the word. That's it. Paul only preached the word. The word has power to heal. Say amen. Amen. The word has power to heal. Three things Paul did. Number one, Paul preached the word. Number two, Paul noticed the man had faith. Number three, Paul commanded the healing. Paul never requested for the healing. Three things Paul did. Repeat after me. Paul preached the word. Number two, Paul saw the man had faith. Number three, Paul commanded the healing. Three things the man did. What are three things the man did? The man listened to Paul. This is key. The man listened to Paul. Number two, the man had faith in the word of God. Say amen. Amen. He believed that God can do what he said he can do. Amen. If God said he can do it, the man believed it. Number three, the man activated his faith. It's easy to sit down and listen and then say, yeah, yeah, that's true, but sorry, it's not for me. I cannot do it. Sorry, I cannot do it. The man believed the word of God. He was crippled from birth. Think about it. He had every reason to protest. Every reason to complain. But no, he believed the word of God. If the word of God said so, it must be true. It must be true. Friends, this is a key today. If you and I can tap into the key. You've probably heard this story of the woman with hemorrhage. Have you heard this story? But there is an important element in the story. I'm not sure you would have heard before, or many really do not know an important element in the story. Many people think it's just the woman's faith, but the woman did not have blind faith. In order to understand the story, let me just go backtrack into that story a little bit of the woman with hemorrhage. Mark chapter 5, verse 25 to 34. It says, a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. And there was a woman who had been suffering from a hemorrhage, a bleeding, for 12 years. How long was this woman bleeding? 12 years. 12 years this woman was bleeding. She had endured much under many physicians, had spent all her money on doctors. And she was no better, but rather grew worse. She was suffering for bleeding for 12 years. She had finished all her money. She had gone from doctor to doctor. She was not getting better, she was getting worse. And then the Bible says something, and really this is the key. She heard about Jesus. Say that. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of. She heard about Jesus. She heard about Jesus, and she came up from behind him in the cloud and touched his cloak, and she said, "If I touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately the hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed. Aware that the power had gone forth, Jesus turned in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" The disciples said, "The crowd is pressing in on you. How can you say who touched you?" He looked around to see who had done it. But a woman, knowing what had happened to her, came forward, fell down, told him the truth. And Jesus said, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." Repeat after me. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Faith in what, friends? Faith in what she had heard about. She's never met Jesus. She's never met Jesus. But she knew what she heard. She knew what she heard. There's something else you need to understand. The book of Leviticus chapter 15, verse 19 to 28. You just write it down and you can go back and look at it. Leviticus 15, 19 to 28 says, when a woman has discharge, bleeding, she's unclean for the period she has discharge. Every place she goes to, every bed she sits on, that place becomes contaminated. It becomes unclean. Every person she touches becomes unclean. Leviticus chapter 15 says, she will be impure for 7 days, and whoever touches her shall be unclean till the evening. And then the Bible goes on to say, everything which she lies on during her impurity will be unclean. Everything she sits upon will be unclean. Whoever touches her bed shall wash his clothes will be unclean till the evening. Whoever touches anything she sits on shall wash his clothes and be unclean till the evening. Whether it's the bed or anything she sits on, it will be unclean. If a man lies with her, he will be unclean. If she has a discharge of blood for many days, she will be unclean for the entire duration of the bleeding. Every bed she sits on will be unclean. Whoever touches these things will be unclean. And the moment she is cleansed. This woman was bleeding for how long? So she was unclean for how long? She couldn't touch people for how long? Can you imagine that? Not able to touch your husband. Not able to touch your children for 12 years. Finish all the money on doctors trying to get well and yet not getting well. Can you imagine that? One word. Tell me what she would have been feeling. One word. Desperate. Very true. She'd be desperate. What? Another word. Huh? Rejected. Desperate. Rejected. One more word. Huh? Frustrated. One more word. Huh? Depressed. Very true. Frustrated. Depressed. Why? For 12 years she's trying. She's not getting anything. There are some people, friends, who come here to Divine Retreat Center out of desperation, frustration, because they want something to change, but they are not ready to pay the price. Tell the person sitting next to you on your right and left, don't be lazy. Look at the person on your right and left. Maybe that brother needs it. Tell that person, look at him in the eyes and tell him, don't be lazy. If you want the touch of God, you got to go and get it. So if you're sitting there and saying, "Oh, I'm so tired, I never sleep last night. I'm so tired." Yeah, hello. Why? Because you don't have spiritual stamina. This woman, 12 years she's suffering. And you know what was the key? 12 years, no contact. But I know something. She had heard about Jesus. But there was another key. She not only heard about Jesus, but it's evident that she knew the Jewish scriptures. It is evident that she knew the Jewish word of God, because she knew that healing was in the word of God. And she knew that through the word of God, she can receive her healing. So her faith, she had heard about what Jesus was doing, but her faith was activated. Because these 12 years, probably, I do not know, it's not written, probably, it is alluded to, but probably this woman, for 12 years, isolated from family, all she was doing was reading the word of God. Say amen. Amen. And how do we know this? How do we know this? Because she went and touched the fringe of his cloak. That's the key. Why do you think she touched the fringe of his cloak? Let me give you an analogy to help you to understand this. Brother, you. Yeah, brother. Brother, can you please come? Come, brother. You. Yes, you. Come up here. Yes, very good. Come up here, sir. Come up. Come up. Very good. Come up. Very good. Please, here, sir. Thank you. What's your name, sir?
Francis D'Souza.
Francis D'Souza. Very good, Francis. Francis, very good. I got something for you here, Francis. I want you to put this on. This is from Jerusalem. This is from Jerusalem, but this is a typical cloak that a male wears. Let me show you how it looks like. Brother, hold. Open it up. It's the other way around. Okay, can you hold it up, brother? Hold it up. This is a typical cloak that the men wear. This is something interesting about a cloak. You see here, the Jewish Torah, the words, the Jewish Torah. And this is the cloak that the man wears. And the cloak has got four fringes. The cloak, this is a cloak, it's called a prayer shawl. In Hebrew, it's called talit. Say talit. Talit. This is a typical cloak that the man wears. And the cloak has got four fringes. Here, that's one. This is two. Over there, brother. Three, four. Can you see the four fringes? Yes? Four fringes. Okay, very good. Brother, you'll be my Jesus. Stand here in the middle. This is how he would look, okay? He'd be wearing this with the, notice the similarity with the stole of the Catholic priest, yes? Over the head, okay? He's having the fringe. Now, this is Jesus. Assume now for the purpose, I'm showing this visually to you so that you can catch this. And this is very important, okay? It says, she came up from behind him and touched the fringe of his clothes. And many people have this idea that this woman just touched a part of the clothes that Jesus was wearing. No, that's not true. The woman specifically reached out for a piece of the cloth. Matthew chapter 9, this particular item is referenced to again and again. Matthew chapter 9 verse 18 to 21. And then suddenly a woman who'd been suffering from hemorrhage for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. And she said, if only I touch the fringe, I will be made well. Matthew chapter 14 verse 34 to 36. When they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret. And the people of that place recognized Jesus. They sent word throughout the region and brought all who were sick and begged him that they might even touch the fringe of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. Mark chapter 6 verse 54 to 56. When he got out of the boat, everyone recognized him and began to bring mats, the sick on mats wherever he was. And they begged him they might even touch the fringe of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. Mark chapter 6 verse 56. All who touched the fringe of his cloak were healed. Luke chapter 8 verse 44. She came up behind and touched the fringe of his cloak. And immediately she was healed. This is the fringe. This is a typical cloak that the Jewish man wears. And this is the hem of the garment. And this is the fringe. This is the hem. The cloak, the prayer shawl is called a talit. The Jewish man, every time he prays, he wears it and then he bows down. Shema Israel Adonai. Shema Israel Adonai. Shema Israel Adonai. He prays. Every time he prays. The talit has got four hems. This hem is called tzitzit. Repeat after me. Tzitzit. The tzitzit has got four knots. One, two, three, four. Four knots. And there are four knots. And it's not by accident. Huh? Each of it has got four knots. And this is done specifically according to Mosaic law. Why? Because in the book of Numbers chapter 15, verse 37 to 41, the Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and tell them to put fringes on the corner of their garments throughout the generation and put a blue cloth, a blue thread on the fringe of each corner. So there are four fringes. There is a blue cord on each of the four corners. Put a blue cord. Say blue cord. Blue thread. The blue thread is intertwined within the tzitzit. Why blue cord? You have the fringes so that when you see it, you will remember all the commands of the Lord and do them and not follow the lust of your own heart or your own eyes. You shall remember and do all the commands and you shall be holy to God. What is the blue thread? The command of God. The word of God. What is the blue thread? The word of God. Now you know why the woman reached and touched the fringe. She was just not reaching and touching any part of the body. She knew the word of God. She knew in Malachi, Malachi chapter 4 verse 2. Hold here, brother. Malachi chapter 4 verse 2, the Bible says, and you shall revere my name, for the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings. Say with me, healing in his wings. Say that. Let me show you the wings. Brother, raise your right hand and left hand. Raise it up. No, this way. Open. Open your hands. Open. No. Don't let go. Yeah, don't let go. Stretch out. Open up, brother. Left and right. Left and right. Yes. What is that? The wings. Can you see the wings? This is the wings. Where is the healing? In the wings. There is healing in the wings. This woman, put the hands down, brother. This woman knew the word of God. It's not a coincidence. Not just random, she simply touched. Turn around, brother. He will be Jesus. I will be the woman. The Bible says She came up from behind him. She had a very specific goal to reach and touch. She reached and touched the fringe, the hem of his garment. The moment she touched, power went out. And instantly, she was healed. Where is the healing? In the Word of God, in the blue thread. Where is the healing? In the blue thread. Say, wow. You know what is our problem? You are lazy to read the Word. Tell the person sitting next to you, don't be lazy. You need to know the key. Say amen. When you know the key, the healing is yours. It is for this reason Jesus turned and said, daughter, your faith has healed you. Faith what? Faith in the Word. He knew instantly. You know why? Because the Bible says so many people rushing around Jesus. Nobody reached and touched the hem except this woman. Why? Only she knew. Today you have the key. Yes? Do you have the key? Where? In your hand. In your hand. Where's the Word of God? Lift up the Bible. Lift up your Bible. Lift up your Bible. Lift it up. If you don't lift up your hand, lift up your Bible, okay? Only lift up your Bible. If you don't have a Bible, after this session, by hook or by crook, go and buy a Bible. Say amen. Amen. Why? This is your key. Lift up your Bible and say, this is the living Word of God. It is alive and active. It is the source of my healing. The moment I believe, the moment I believe, the faith is activated. I receive my healing in Jesus' name. If you don't have your Bible, you better go and make sure you buy one now. Amen? Amen. Thank you, brother. Praise the Lord. Brother, can you do me a favor? Can you please fold it for me and just put it there for me? This is the key, friends. Many people think for a long time that this lady is just some random healing. No, it's just healing in the Word. It's healing in the Word of God. The Bible tells us in Psalm 107, verse 19 to 20, they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them in their distress. They cried out to the Lord in their trouble. He saved them in their distress. How? He sent his Word and healed them. Say amen. How did he do it? He sent his Word. He sent his Word and healed them from their destruction. Exodus chapter 15, verse 22 to 27. Exodus chapter 15, verse 22 to 27. It tells about the people of Israel coming out of the Red Sea, and they were wandering in the wilderness of Shur. Say with me, wilderness of Shur. It's a desert. Wilderness of Shur. They were wandering in the wilderness of desert. In the desert. 3 days in the wilderness, they had no water. How long no water? 3 days in the wilderness, no water. 3 days. 3 days in the wilderness, there was no water. No water. They came to a place called Marah. They could not drink the water of Marah because the water of Marah was bitter. That is why it was called Marah. I come from Malaysia, and in Malaysia, the word Marah means angry. So they were very angry because there was no, there was water. The water they drank was bitter. They were very angry. They were upset. So what did they do? They complained. Again, you see, the key is in your mouth. They could have believed. Am I right? Because they had seen God do signs and wonders to bring them out of Egypt. Am I right? What's the big deal with the water? But no. Good Catholics, yes. Small problem, a big complaint. No faith. They started to complain, saying, what can we drink? What will we drink? And Moses cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a piece of wood. Say this with me. The Lord showed him a piece of wood. Say it again. Where was the wood? It was there. It was there. The wood was already there. The wood didn't fly from Dubai, take Emirates Airline and come there in the middle of the desert. The wood was already there. But you know what is the problem? When you're going through the trouble, you cannot see the wood. The wood is already there. Say that with me. People have the wood, but they're still running for healing. Somebody says healing coming to Mumbai, everybody will run to Mumbai. Some say healing coming to Bangalore, everybody will run to Bangalore. Why are you running after healing? The word is already there. What is the word? The word of God. It's already there. The Lord showed him the wood. The Lord showed him the wood. He threw the wood into the water and the water became sweet. The water became sweet. The water changed from bitter to sweet. And there the Lord made them a statute and ordinance and there he put them to the test. And this is what the Lord said. If you will listen carefully to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right, and give heed to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will not bring any of the diseases upon the Egyptians. For I am the Lord who heals you. Say amen. Amen. That means if you obey the word of God, you will not get sick. If you obey the commandment, if you listen to the voice of the Lord your God, do what is right, give heed to his commandments, I will heal you. Much of the problem is because we cannot obey. And after that, the Bible says, then they came to Elim. Say Elim. And in Elim, there was 12 springs of water and 70 palm trees. And they camped there by the water. Say Shur. Say Shur. Wilderness of Shur. Say Elim. Say Shur. Say Elim. In Shur is a desert. The water is bitter. Shur is a desert. The water is bitter. Elim has got 12 springs of water. 12 springs of water. 70 palm trees. What is God trying to do? When he takes you through the problem, he's trying to teach you something. Say amen. Amen. He's trying to take you from Shur to Elim is the place of your blessing. 12 springs of water, 70 palm trees is there. But you know what? You're not patient enough. You don't want to learn. You are complaining. Ensure you're complaining. Why? Why I have to do this? Why I have to read the word? Why I have to pray? Very hard to pray. Name of the Father and the Son and the Holy. Sleep. Next morning, wake up. Spirit, amen. Notice, When you're watching Hindi movie, that time you're not sleepy. When you're gossiping, you're not sleepy. When you're playing pool, you're not sleepy. When you're praying, that's when you're sleepy. Why? Because your spiritual stamina is so weak. You've got to become strong. Say amen.
Amen.
You've got to discipline yourself. Because no Shur, no Elim. No such thing as shortcut. Tell the person sitting next to you, no shortcut. Say amen.
Amen.
So next time you feel sleepy, give yourself a slap in the face. And tell yourself, wake up. If you want your blessing, wake up. Tell the person sitting next to you, wake up. Amen. Do you want your 12 springs of water and 70 palm trees? Do you want? Yes. Do you want 70 palm trees, 12 springs of water? Do you want? Yes, brother, I want. Then go through your shore. Discipline yourself. Take the wood and put it in the water. This is how your life will be changed. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20 to 22. Proverbs 4, 20 to 22. My child, be attentive to my words. Incline your ear to my saying. Do not let them escape from your sight. Keep them within your heart, for they are life to all who find them and healing to all the flesh. Five things we can learn from that woman, friends. She had expectant faith. She believed the word of God. Just like at the crippled man at Lystra, he believed the word of God. He had expectant faith. That's why he was listening to the word of God. He had boldness. The woman with hemorrhage had boldness. If they had caught her, they would have stoned her to death. Because the number of people she defiled, made unclean by pushing through the crowd. But she had boldness. Catholics today have laziness. But they want their healing. This woman had boldness. She focused on Jesus, not on the healing. Tell the person sitting on your right and left, focus on Jesus. Amen? Focus on Jesus. She had exhausted every method. She overcame her fear and her shame. She overcame her fear and her shame. And the consequence, the Bible says, Jesus looked for her. Amazing, yes. Not she looking for Jesus. Jesus looking for her. Jesus turned around and said, who touched me? The disciples said, Master, how can you ask that? So many people are touching you. Jesus said, no, somebody touched me. And the Bible says very specifically, Jesus turned and looked around to see who touched him. Jesus looked for her. Jesus knew there was this woman. Friend, when your faith is activated, you don't need to look for Jesus. Jesus will look for you. Say amen.
Amen.
Number two, in all recorded scripture, there was only one time Jesus ever called a woman daughter. This was the moment. Jesus called the woman daughter. You know why? Because the moment you know who you are, the moment you read the word of God, your identity changes. Say amen.
Amen.
You're no more a beggar. You're no more a pauper. You become the son and daughter of God. Say amen.
Amen.
He called her daughter. This is the only time Jesus addressed somebody daughter. Jesus said, your faith has healed you. Your faith has healed you. Faith in what? Faith in the living word of God has healed you. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. Friends, Jesus wants to touch you. He wants to heal you. But it's not abracadabra. Say amen. It's not magic. Are you ready to pay the price?
Yes, very soft. Sleepy, brother. Very sleepy. I just have coffee, brother.
Give yourself a slap in the face. Listen, which is easier? Until it's so bad, you end up in the hospital and the doctors are putting all the tubes around you, and that time you say, I want to have faith. Or now. Now. Look at a person sitting next to you and tell them, don't wait till it's too late. Amen. When do you activate your faith? When do you begin to believe the word of God? Not tomorrow. Now. Amen. So would you stand to your feet? We want to pray. Would you stand to your feet? We want to pray. We want to activate that faith. Amen. So that you can allow the power of the word of God to flow through you and to touch you and to change you. Close your eyes, stretch out your hands, both left hand and right hand, lift it up high and begin to praise the Lord out loud with me. Praise you, Jesus.